and elected officials at the county. And one of the best that we have is David Orr, our county clerk. And the county clerk, like the rest of county government, which I always say is stealth government, nobody's quite sure what we do. He has some remarkable responsibilities, and we're going to talk about two of them tonight. The biggest one being his responsibility as the primary election official for the county. And I want to point out to you that the suburban part of Cook County is where he is the election official. We are in the suburban areas, actually bigger now than the city of Chicago. And yet, we're required as a county board to fund the Chicago Board of Elections. And David will make some comments, but I will tell you that it has bothered me a lot that we actually give the city of Chicago's Board of Elections more money than we give to our own county clerk to run the elections because of a lot of Byzantine laws and interactions. One of the things we need to do is to try to streamline this whole voting process, because as we saw in the primaries, even with contested races going on around us, the turnout was really, really small. The General Assembly in this election cycle has done a number of changes that David will walk you through. These were supported by our local state representatives and state senators, and I'm going to ask Laura Fine, whose district we are currently standing in, along with Senator Biss, whose district we're standing in. I'm told Robin Gable will come by, our third co-sponsor, a little later. But I'm going to ask them to just kind of come up and talk a little bit about the election bill as they see it and what we're trying to do here tonight, which is give you information that will help us get more people registered and get more people to turn out. When I was in the Air Force during the Vietnam era, it always bothered me that we were fighting a war for democracy and yet our turnouts in the United States were low, but they were double where we are today. We've got kids who are fighting in Afghanistan and troops that are coming back into Iraq, where again we're trying to establish democracy. And we need to set an example, and so the purpose of this meeting tonight is for all of you to take information, bring it back, and help us get people to vote. I don't care who they vote for, we just need them to exercise their voting rights. Now, David also has the responsibility on your tax bills, and many of you have them, and you've got to pay them by August 1st. David's responsibility in his office is to determine the rates for the various governments. But he is also in this tax bill, if you live in a TIF district, he's put information on it. And I'd like him at the end, after we've talked about elections, to talk a little bit about TIFs and how we get more transparency into these tax bills. Now, I'd like to ask Laura Fine to come on up and just make some welcoming comments, and then I'll ask Senator Biss, and then we'll turn this over to David. Laura?
Very near and dear to my heart. How do we get more people to participate in the process? How do we get more people out to vote? And what we've done in the General Assembly this year, with so much help from the Cook County Clerk's Office, is really take important steps to have access for more people to cast a ballot. It was very exciting for me in March, because Illinois passed the first initiative to allow 17-year-olds to vote in the primary election if they will be old enough to vote in the general. So I was able to sit next to my son for the first time as he voted. And that had such an impact on me, because you realize that these kids are going to be 18 when they...
Can you have two people in the booth?
What? No, he sat next to me. I had my booth.
Judge.
I didn't even look to see who he voted for. But I have an idea. I hope. But for him, it was saying, you know, I'm going to be 18 and vote in the general election, and I'm able to choose the candidates that I'm hopefully going to be able to vote for when it does come time to the general election. We've now taken the next step, and David Orr is going to talk about the importance of those next steps. One, which is so important, is same-day registration, because if you're an election judge, you know there are a lot of people who move, don't realize that they needed to change their registration before election day, come out to vote, and realize that they are unable to cast the ballot at that particular place. And so we're going to get a lot of confusion out of the voting process and allow more people to participate. So thank you so much for all you have done, and thank you, Larry, for holding this event tonight.
Thanks, sir. Now, Senator Daniel Biss. He's so young, but he's become the oracle of the Senate.
God help us. Well, thanks, Larry, for putting on this event. It's, I think, really an important thing to do. Laura pretty much covered the basic situation. I would just add that let's all acknowledge that voting is changing, that early voting is still kind of a new thing, and its prevalence and its adoption is really quite new. The concept of voting by mail as opposed to only voting absentee if you happen to truly be out of town, that's a very recent change in Illinois, one that people are still getting used to. And these are all really, really good evolutions that are part of expanding the franchise and making it as easy as possible for people to vote. But because we choose to adopt them in a cautious, gradual manner to make sure they're done properly, to make sure they're done without allowing opportunities for fraud, it means we do them slowly, we do them gradually, and there's this constant change. And so it's very, very helpful to have David here. I really appreciate your coming up to Wilmette to walk people through the way things are going to be, even though we understand things will continue to change. We'll eventually have a completely all online set of electronic poll books that will allow comprehensive same day registration. We'll make the process that much easier for everybody. But here we are in 2014 making one important step, and I'm glad to have been a tiny part of making that happen, and really glad that we have such a great elected official to come here and educate us in some of the details of how it will go. So I'm looking forward to learning, and want to thank all of you for being here this evening.
When I met David Orr, he was a professor at Mundelein College, and he was thinking of running for alderman of the 49th Ward, and he somehow mobilized a lot of his students to help him in that election. One of the changes he's going to talk about is easier ways for college students to get registered and to vote, and I would hope you'll listen to those things. He's been our county clerk since 1990. He is considered an international expert on elections. He is often asked to monitor elections in difficult parts of the world. His staff is probably the best staff for understanding the equipment and understanding the laws. Everybody in this state, when there's an election bill, looks to David's office to take the lead. This is not a partisan issue. This is very much a Democratic, with a small d, issue of getting people out to vote and our need to participate in democracy. So it's a great pleasure, and I'm very grateful to him to come up to my district. David Orr, the county clerk of Cook County.
Thank you very much, Larry. You all are very lucky here to have the kind of elected talent you have. Of course, we all compliment each other in the beginning, but I don't usually say things and I don't mean it, those of you that know me. Larry Suffredin is a great commissioner. He's great because he speaks his mind, which means he often gets people who are powerful a little upset. Because he's bright, he studies the issues. Nobody knows more on a daily basis going on in the county than Larry. And the others we'll talk about later, but Daniel, Laura, who else is here, you're really lucky. And that shows that there's a talented voting population. So I have nothing but good things to say about them. First of all, let me just say very quickly, oh, we're going to do a little PowerPoint if you can see it. If not, fine.
Okay, we're going to put the lights down so that they should be able to see.
As long as I can see. Put the lights down. Well, that's not going to work. I'll punch good.
Yeah, that's good.
Can you see okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Again, you may be able to see it okay, and if not, you know, we're going to talk about it. But
sorry.
Trying to make it worse? No, not in Wilmette.
There you go.
I don't remember. I'm old. I don't got good ears. I don't got eyes. I can barely stand. So we'll still get through it the best we can. But first, just briefly, we want to know what our office does. Larry mentioned a couple things. So the issue, of course, that's most popular people know about is run elections, which of course we do. Next slide. And so secondly, vital records, you get all that birth, marriage, and death records and other things from our office. Keep in mind, we have something new. We have a lot of new technology, even though I'm not a technology guy, but I've got really wonderful people that work for me. Something called Genealogy Online. And it's just something that's it's taken off worldwide. It's popular. It saves us enormous amount of staff time. It just means people who are looking for people can go online and often find them, which saves everybody lots of time and money. So that's the Vitals Department. The Tax Department, like I said, one of the responsibilities we have is to set the tax rates for the roughly 1,500 taxing bodies. Big ones like Chicago, small ones like the Dixmoor Park District, or perhaps the Wilmette Park District. In that process, by the way, one of the things we do in setting the tax rates is we have this fiduciary responsibility to provide information about TIFs, tax increment financing. We'll discuss it later, but that's why we have a responsibility when it comes to TIFs. We're also clerk of the board, and people like Larry keep us working all the time, so we keep all the folks, we keep all the laws, all the information about what those commissioners do or don't do. Okay? And then finally, we have an ethics department. All the people who lobby in Cook County have to keep their information with us. And then also something called an Illinois requirement of a certain number of officials in the county of Cook, about 25,000, have to file these statements of economic interest. It's meant to try and guarantee that people don't have conflicts of interest. We've also modernized that. It's online, so it's much easier for people to look around and so forth. Okay, so what I want to jump to is that we, unlike some states, and I'm proud right now to be in a state that's trying to expand the franchise. We know of so many opportunities. If you want to talk about it, I'd be glad to, but I wasn't going to start with it, of all the voter suppression around the country. But we have a history, I think, in recent years of trying to expand the franchise. One of the national things, oh, I've got to get the picture in there, when under President Clinton, we signed the National Voter Registration Act. And of course, we got people from League One Voters who were very active with that fight at the time. So that gave us voter. And still today, probably 70 to 75% of all the people that register, and perhaps higher today, register through that act. Okay. The fun thing was, by the way, is that since I was in a big city, I got to hang around with Bill a little before, and he was showing me the red phone to the left before all those other people came in. But we didn't use it. Okay, so that continues in Illinois in the last few years. A number of things have happened, again, with the help of your legislators and the ones that aren't here. Okay, there's other women, Judge Robin.
Robin is here, so just
came in. Robin here. Welcome, Robin Gable. The help of people like Robin Gable, Lou Lang, Heather Staines, if I leave anybody else out.
Kelly Cassidy.
Oh, Elaine Neckritz, you know, you got a lot of talent. But so, student election judges, how many of you are judges here? We got a few. Student election judges is something we introduced back in 2000. It's turned out to be wonderful. A great way to get students involved, and they are very helpful in the process. Grace period registration, talked about that a little bit. Early voting, become very popular in Illinois. No excuse mail voting, Daniel mentioned that. It's now, people still don't quite realize that everybody has a choice to vote for mail. Vote by mail if you want, okay? And then last year, again, as I think Laura referred to, is that the legislature passed the 17-year-old voting, which first went into effect this year. And thanks to all the school districts of both Chicago and Cook County, thousands of 17-year-olds registered to vote. It's really exciting. Now we'll see what happens come November. And then finally, and we'll turn to that for a moment, is the online voter registration. But let me first just quickly jump ahead. Okay, well, I'm not sure if I can see this in the right order, but on online voter registration, this is a tool, like I say, the legislators passed. What's important about this, and a lot of what we're talking about tonight, is not very sexy, but it's practical things to make the system work better. Online voter registration means now, as of July 1st, you can take your phone or laptop or whatever, and you can simply register or re-register this way. Now, the only people who can do it, which is most Illinoisans, but you have to have a driver's license or a state ID. So that is a limit, but still the vast majority of Illinoisans. When California implemented this law just a few years ago, tens and tens of thousands of people in the last few weeks before the election actually registered. And it's really good for not just young people, but those who this is their way of communicating these days. So it's an easy way to do it, much more efficient, save money, gradually reducing paper. Now, that will be gradually improved. One piece of advice we'd give is that the State Board is doing well on it, but it's a little harder to find their site. So anybody that wants to register anywhere in Illinois, if they go on our site, cookcountyclerk.com, and look to, you know, register to vote, we will take you right to this, right, not just to the site, but to where you fill in your name so that you can be registered online. So that's a good thing. It'll be, the technology will keep improving, but because of technical advances like this, a lot of what else we're going to talk about we can do. Now I just, the next one, just quickly, something about disability rights champions. Again, I've already thanked people, but all the folks in this area, now particularly the new legislation, of course, you see up there the governor, Barbara Finn Curry and Don Harmon played crucial roles, but so did Daniel Lane and all the other people here in passing the legislation that we're going to talk about. Okay, so let's talk about the specifics, okay, of this new bill that we're kind of bragging about. It does three major things, okay? It extends early voting, okay? And how it does that is the following. On the week before the election, it now, early voting will go until 7 p.m. That's an attempt. Those people, you know, many thousands of people vote during the day, but now you can vote till 7 p.m. And then, for the first time, on the Sunday before the election, you can always, at least in the past, you could vote on the Saturday, but now you can vote on the Sunday before the election. Okay, so that's expanding early voting opportunities to deal with the realities of people working mobility. And then secondly, we're expanding what we call grace period. Okay, now, over the years, the traditional registration in Illinois ended about a month before the election. And then the legislator said, you know what, we can't quite get the same day yet, so let's see if we can find other ways for those people who forgot. Because what happens around October 4th? It's the second biggest moving day in the year, okay? And tens of thousands of people move, and they're, you know, grabbing their boxes and trying to get friends to help them and blah, 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 and they may not get registered. So grace period means that at certain selective sites, people could still, after that date, a month before the election, they still have time to go and register and vote. It's called same day register and vote. Now that's been taking place for a while, but we're expanding that due to this new legislation. Okay, so that means when you go to the early voting sites in Cook County, we have about 43 or 44 of those, you could also go after what would be around October 7th, I believe, is a Tuesday before the election, a month before the election. You can still go to any of these sites, even if you're not registered, okay? And the third big thing is what we call election day registration. So the first time in Illinois at selected sites, and I have to emphasize that because it's a pilot program, at selected sites, people who missed all of that can still register and vote on election day. So the good news is that an experiment moving that way, the states that do it have better turnout, sometimes up to 14% of the people who vote on election day are people who do on the same day. So it's got a good track record, no particular problems, good track record, but we're going to start slow because it's not at all sites. Now, I do hope that when we talk to you again, it'll be in all precincts, because this means that if you're one of those people, for whatever reason, you know, your mom's been sick for a month and you just didn't get re-registered, you can do an election day, but it's not going to be easy. You've got to go to one of these sites, so you have to travel. Okay, for the activists out there, campaigns will do it. Yes, sir?
I had a question, so there are local candidates on a ballot in a precinct, and if someone moves and they go to a precinct or they go to their old precinct and they want to register and vote on election day, how do you know which ballot you get? I mean, what if they actually show up at the wrong polling? I mean, if it's a centralized location, you can give them the ballot for their local election, but if they go out to a precinct, they're not going to have ballots for other precincts or other localities. So.
At this point, like I say, it's just going to be at selective sites, so you're right. But in the future, people will be able to do that. For example, when you vote on cut screen, or like when you go to early voting, you could live here and you can go in Oak Park and vote. okay? Because on the touchscreen, because of technology, we have all the data for everybody. So if you vote at 9 o'clock in the morning at Wilmette and you go to Evanston at 9:30, you can't vote because we have that. So we have the tools to do that in the future. And I think it was Daniel or maybe Larry mentioned, we're also interested in something new in Cook County, and that is what's called electronic poll books. Again, it's all technology. We've done that a number of precincts. Maybe some of you judges have used it. It's simply having like a little computer at the polling place. Something we've always wanted, because sometimes these polling places you can't reach people. But anyway, it's a good tool. So that'll be that'll help us as same day expands in the future. Okay. And so for Election Day registration, we'd be the 14th state to be doing it in the country. And you'd have to have the same kind of two-piece identification that you register any place else in Illinois. Now, one thing that's important about the Election Day registration is it will be a provisional ballot. What provisional ballot means is the federal legislation, which I think is a good one, said a few years ago that a provisional ballot means, what if we made a mistake? And this has happened before. What if a husband and wife register, let's say Secretary of State's office, somebody clamps them together and only the wife gets registered? The husband shows up, hey, what do you mean I'm not registered? Humans make mistakes. Provisional voting means you can still vote on election day. We don't throw you out and send you home. You still vote, and then we separate or segregate your ballot from all the others, and then we have 2 weeks legally to count those. And what we do is we review all the process and we determine whether or not, oh yeah, we have the record somehow, or maybe the Secretary of State's office had it or something. And so if we find the record, we count your ballot. If not, we don't count your ballot, but we automatically register you. So that's provisional. So those people that vote on election day, at least in November, will vote a provisional ballot just to make sure that we can keep track of everything. Yes, sir.
I'm a township committeeman now, but I used to be an election judge. And we did provisional ballots, and I think the voter had to appear in person. He had a certain window of time to appear in person to validate the provisional ballot. Is that still required?
It says what's required. What that means is sometimes in challenges, like we'll go through a process, a very transparent process, and we'll say, Laura's, whatever, we found the records, we count the vote, okay? But when you get to challenges, and you're maybe like we have tie votes in Cook County, if you believe that. Or sometimes elections decided by two or three votes, particularly in some of the smaller districts. Then in a challenge process, you can actually maybe go and talk to those people, make sure, there is options, but that's not an automatic thing that you need to come in. Okay. But so the main point we're saying, when it comes to election day, the votes will be counted as provisional votes this time, okay? This just explains why this is important. Why did these legislators act and why we encourage them to act? This is not because a bunch of people are lazy and we're just trying to force them to be registered. This is because we're extremely mobile society. Okay, just some numbers if you can see them. Within Cook County alone, 550,000 people annually. Okay, what this means, now any of you that are political out there, just think of when you go past petitions. You can work really hard and you can discover that 50% of all the people that sign petitions turn out not to be registered where they say they were. Okay, it's a big issue around the country, particularly in places like Chicago, Cook County. People move a lot. They do not realize they have to change every time. Okay, and that's one of the key issues we're trying to deal with, to deal with that problem. Okay, so partly we're doing this because of that mobility. Now, some quick challenges to this law. Okay, keep in mind that it's going to be administered somewhat differently in different places because these rules, particularly for expanded, both for same day and expanded early voting, you have some leeway as determining the number of sites. So for example, in Cook County, when I said we have 43 or 44 normal sites, okay, we're going to try and have on that Sunday early voting, right, Gail? I got to introduce some of the people here in a minute. We're going to have hopefully 10 to 15 sites, maybe more than that. But a lot of places around the state will only have one. Okay, Chicago right now is saying they're going to have four. My guess is that there'll be a lot of pressure on the legislators to encourage them to have more. okay? And so one of the challenges for us and for you who are communicating with your constituents is on Saturday, the Saturday before the election, we've got 44 sites. And yet on Sunday, let's say we have 15. We don't want people going to here, for example, if early voting ends here on Saturday, it's not available on Sunday. So those are the challenges, logistics we'll have to deal with. So let's see, so we covered that. So that's the new legislation, the three critical things. Yes, sir?
Just a quick question, just so I can visualize it. That same-day voter registration, how many sites do you hope to have? A half dozen? Or
we about the same. We hope to have about 10 to 15. If we can go higher than that, we can. And part of the reason why they call us a pilot is this all is a big challenge. Remember, we're going nuts the last few days. We're also voting in nursing homes, hundreds of them, all throughout the county on the Saturday and Sunday, Monday before the election. So a lot of things are going on, and we have to have time to get all that equipment prepped and back and et cetera. So that's what we're hoping to have. Now, some jurisdictions will only have one. So you'll have places that a downstate county may have to drive 35 miles to the county seat. So it's not going to be as attractive, but it's a step in the right direction. Okay, and I think as Daniel said, we believe, I think most of us really believe, that by the next election, meaning 2016, probably not the off year local elections, we believe we could implement it all precincts. And then it really works well. That's where you get your bigger turnout.
Are the minimums in the statute, so many cities with some municipalities with some hundreds of thousands of people are required to have
the statute is silent on that, okay? The only, the statute does touch the issue of early voting sites, and it's frankly only because people felt that some clerks were ignoring the more popular parts. So now there's something called permanent sites. If I'm remembering right, we have seven of those in Cook County. And again, it's by legislation. So basically what the legislator said is, it's your biggest towns have to have an early voting site. And frankly, that was directed honestly, at Lake County, when the clerk wouldn't put early voting sites in North Chicago or Waukegan, I believe that's probably what it was about. Or down in Champaign, when the county clerk ignored the students who said, please put the early voting site in the student union where we all go, and it was put as far away from campus as possible. So the legislators stepped in. And while they solved one problem, the only difference about those permanent sites is it means now we have two sites in Cicero because they are the biggest town and very few people go there. But by law, we have something called permanent sites. But some of this is inside baseball, so I don't want
to. When you say we hope to have these in every precinct, you're talking about Cook County suburbs, you're not talking about all of Illinois.
No, the goal for Election Day registration, that many of the groups that you've read about, Common Cause, perhaps the League, I think, but I'm not sure, these organizations will want to see Election Day registration, some people call it same day registration throughout the state. That would mean that all polling places would be open to it.
All over the state.
Yeah, that would be the goal. In fact, all these laws affect the whole state. It's just that if a downstate county only has one early voting site, then they only have one. Whereas we have 44, Chicago's got 51, Lake has several, Kane County has a lot, but a lot of the downstate counties that only have 15,000 voters don't. Okay, I'm gonna finish up quickly and we'll go with more questions. Something else I wanna jump on, it's called All In. Now what we did with the legislature I think was great, but we're not done yet because there's so much more we could do to modernize the elections, okay? And in my office, I got some great people. Some of them are here tonight, some of them very young, but all committed to doing great things. Like I say, they're not terribly sexy. But what we call this move to modernize the voter registration process, we just call it All In. And simply what it means is the modernized agency registration simply is there's a lot of data there. Share it. Okay, share it. Okay? For example, when you register, when you go to a driver's facility, you can automatically register to vote. But if you do it by mail, it's not quite so simple, okay? And there's something else that Ryan Chu, raise your hand, keeps talking about there from Evanston. We have, 11 million records of people that annually have to renew their stickers on their driver's license. What if simply that? When you sit in for that, or you did it online to do your sticker, it means you're probably moving or you're getting something. If you have moved, you can automatically re-register, boom, done. So all in is one, to use these agencies, that number one up there, and share the data more successfully. Number two, we said create inclusive voter rolls. What this is about is that there's ways to get lots of information about our voter list. You all have heard and complained, my God, why is this person on the list? They moved 12 years ago. But this person unfortunately passed away 6 years ago. Okay. Modern technology allows us to do things we couldn't before. For example, the state of Illinois, we're doing some of this stuff. We have actually been able to move over 100,000 people just in the last year. Now, when you move 100,000 people off your list, not only making your list more accurate, so you don't have to ask how come they're still there, but you're also saving a ton of money, and the judges that know, and so you don't have to print their application at the polling place. All sorts of things you don't have to do. This is all possible now. There's something called ERIC, which is basically a group of states who said, you know what, let's get together, let's make this information available so we can clean our list. Republican states, Democratic states, we think it's a great thing. We're trying to get Chicago to join. I'm not Chicago, but we're trying to get the state of Illinois to join. Almost had it this past time. We'll go back to hopefully win it in veto session. And it means that now we can share data in Illinois, which is good. We do it all the time. But what happens? There'd be 500,000 people we could clean our list with who moved out of Chicago and re-registered in Virginia, North Carolina, whatever. Okay. Or, unfortunately, thousands of people who died. If they don't die in Cook County, we don't have their record. But if they're in an ERIC state, boom, all of a sudden. So that's what that's all about, the second point about inclusive voter rolls. And finally, what fill the gaps. The fill the gaps basically means that there's where Election Day comes in. If we try everything else, then same day is a way to capture other people. There's something else quickly, I know it's inside baseball, but NCOA, some of you have heard of that, National Change of Address card. Okay. So when you move, you fill out that card, and therefore the idea is a post office to send your mail to the next place. Okay. Well, again, we think that should be available in all of Illinois. So if you move tomorrow from Wilmette to Springfield, and you send an NCOA card, why wouldn't we automatically update your registration at the same time? Boom, done. Okay. That's what we're getting at. We're a lot of ways to skin the cat. We've got Mike Kreloff in the back, who's probably the most respected person in the election business that helps us out down in Springfield. We have these great legislators. So we're working to push this through. At the same time, we're getting help from various government agencies working on this right now. We're with the governor's office and other groups to try and implement things that we can do without legislation. So it's basically a modernizing our voter registration rolls, which frankly need it because we're old fashioned, there's nothing universal about our, in the nation, it's all done by state and varies from state to state, county to county. So that's a goal that we're working on, we're very excited about it. Now just quickly, and then we'll get back to more questions or comments. Larry mentioned the TIFs, okay, only a very few points to make. A TIF is something that's called tax increment financing. And that is a great economic tool that has swept the nation. Many states approve it, many localities do it, suburbs do it, city does it. Okay. What it basically means is a municipality can take a particular geographical area and they can say within that geographical area that all the properties there, their evaluation will be frozen at this spot. Okay. And if they go up, which they almost always do, the increase will not go to the existing taxing bodies, it will go into the quote TIF. The TIF fund to be used, hopefully, for something constructive. Okay, so when it works well, you take a very depressed area where no private capital will go in. It was all in for a long time in the Rogers Park area. We put a TIF in the more depressed area, the northern Rogers Park area, and partly because of that today we have Dominick's, now we have a new Jewel, we have a whole shopping center, we have LA Fitness, and it worked. Using the TIF money to prepare the property, et cetera, led to development, economic development that wouldn't have been there otherwise. Okay, so that's what a TIF is. And I'm not gonna get into all the battles right now unless you wanna ask questions. But four things I wanted to know about the TIF. Number one, if you wanna know more about TIFs, we have a really good video that explains it on our website at cookcountyclerk.com. Understanding tips. That's one thing we do nowadays, and like I say, I'm pretty weak, although I've given speeches around the country on social media, that people don't realize how little I know, but I've got good staff. So understanding tips, it's a great little video. Number two, we do our big TIF annual report this Wednesday. And at that time, we'll be announcing, we can't say it all right now, but basically, we can tell you that revenue is down about 7.5% in the city. And we still have, the numbers don't change a lot. TIFs are actually going up in the suburbs, decreasing slightly in the city. But we're still talking about nearly $700 million of property tax money that most people don't know about going into TIF fund. The suburbs are better, and I think they're better partly because people know about them. Okay, in a big city like Chicago, it's hard to keep in mind. $500 million in the city of Chicago from 130, 40 TIFs, really hard to keep track of. A few in Evanston, easier to follow. The biggest one up here is the former base up there. That's the biggest TIF in this region. So, but secondly, we'll be announcing that this week, if you're interested in that kind of stuff. Third, the good news, thanks to Bill Vassilopoulos. Raise your hand, Bill. Bill Vassilopoulos, a Will Met resident, I believe. Is that right?
Northfield.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Close.
Bill Vassilopoulos is the most talented person in the county when it comes to TIFs and some of this financial information. Very lucky to have him. But with his help and help from the county, your tax bills, which you have seen now, actually, if you're in a TIF, you'll actually see that. Now, don't remember, most of you are not in TIFs. About 12% of the electorate, the taxpayers, are in a TIF. But if you are in a TIF, what you'll see is you'll see the other governing bodies, you know, Cook County, schools, parks, whatever it is, and then you'll see TIF. And it's kind of stunning to some people, because some people look at it and they say, wait a second, I'm paying a $6,000 bill, $4,000 is going to the TIF. Nothing's going to the schools this year. Okay? And it can be a little confusing, but we want you to be able to see that. Okay? So if you're saying, well, wait a second, he left it off my bill, it's only because you're not in the TIF. Okay? But if you're in a TIF, it'll be on your tax bill. It's part of the, it's really difficult to do because of our antiquated taxing system, but it's a great thing. Okay? And the last thing, again, for those of you that are interested in this stuff, we're going to be announcing later in the week about the new TIF viewer. And that, again, technology, again, you're going to be able to basically have an interacting mapping tool for TIFs. You'll be able to sit there in front of your computer and you can search for specific TIFs and you can do all sorts of things. You can look at the broader thing of looking at the whole half the city. You can narrow down to a particular TIF into the boundaries that might be the whole TIF. You can narrow down to a particular piece of property and you can see the amount of money that it's all generating for that TIF. So it's partly technology and Bill and the county's work, but it helps because people are concerned about, let's say, the politics of TIFs, which I wasn't going to raise tonight, but I'm always willing to discuss it. So let me just finish on that point, is that we're excited about these election reforms. They won't be easy. There's some logistic challenges for us in the election business, but it's, I think, where Larry started with. There's nothing wrong with trying to make it convenient. We're not trying to make people vote that don't want to. But let's at least make sure they can be registered. If we do the things we're talking about, we could go from our presently 75% of eligible people in Illinois who are registered to vote, we could get that number to 97%. And the list would be cleaner. So there's a lot of good stuff here. And thank you for listening and questions and comments, okay?
David had a press release in which he announced that you were going to have all this TIF information on your tax bill, and so I got my tax bill, and I kept reading it back and forth and back and forth, and all I found was I could go to his website, and then I realized I didn't live in a TIF, so it becomes a significant thing.
Even the brilliant commissioner needed a little help on that.
Yeah. Robin Gables joined us, and I gave everybody else a chance to talk. Robin, you want to come up and say a few words about either TIFs or
TIFs.
The election bill that you voted for?
TIFs in Glenview.
Or the award that you won?
No.
She wins so many, she doesn't even know.
We could. Anyway.
Well, it's great to be here. Sorry I was a little late. I was in the Wilmette Library, but apparently that wasn't where this meeting was at. You know, voter registration to me, I've been working on this issue for a long time, and I wish that as long as I've been working on it, we'd be in a better place now than we were years ago. But I was involved in the very first deputy registrars. Does anybody remember when we finally got the city of Chicago to allow us people to be deputized and go out and register people to vote? So before that, everybody had to individually do it. And we thought that was an incredible breakthrough at the time. And we had all these sworn deputies, and we had everybody out there registering voters. And it was really a very, very exciting time. So I am so thrilled that we have come a long way from there. But to me, we still have a lot farther to go. And I really would like to see a time when people can vote online in the privacy of their own house, just log in, vote, and be done with it. I think that that would really encourage more people to vote. And I think what we really want is 100% of the people voting. And we don't have that right now. So I think we need to do everything we can to make sure that we get everybody voting in Illinois. So thank you, I'm glad you're all here. David, you did a fabulous job. Thank you so much, and I look forward to the discussion.
Good evening. I've been an election judge probably 20 years and an equipment manager when that program started, and now I'm an electronic book qualifier. And I also am the coordinator for Republican election judges in New Trier. And first, I'd like to congratulate Mr. Orr and his office, and especially Kim Gregg, who's a treasurer. She is the coordinator for New Trier. And my experience, probably as one of the two Republicans in place, has been that your office has been meticulously nonpartisan in every interaction I've ever had with them, all the training, election day, everything. I can only speak for myself. But I had two questions. The first was, with respect to election day, there were situations where you needed voter ID because the person hadn't voted. So the first question was, and let me ask you both, then you can answer both. First question is that changing where we never had, they just had to do the signature, but in certain circumstances, they had to produce ID? That's question number one. Question two, almost everything I know about voting is from Gail's wonderful classes taken many, many, many times. And we heard two things there. Not just that everybody who's entitled to vote should vote. The flip side was that only people entitled to vote should get to vote. And all those fine young men in Afghanistan fighting for our country and doing wonderful things. The only poll that counts is on election day. All the other polls are BS. That's the only poll. And I think the defending both the right to vote and only the privilege of voting is very important. Let me cite an experience. I'm up in Glencoe. It's very genteel. Nothing ever happens there. So that's not typical. But I was also did early voting for about 4 days in Niles, which is a United Nations over in Niles. And we had probably in the 4 days a dozen situations where people came in. They were elderly people, they were with their children, and you'd say good morning, and it was obvious it would be like me going to vote in Sofia, Bulgaria, and they would say good morning in Bulgarian, and no recognition. So these people had not even the simplest command of English, but they wanted to vote, and they were on the rolls in the computer. So of course, they got to vote. But the question I asked for your office was, how did they become citizens? Because you don't have to be, you know, Shakespeare or Churchill, but you're supposed to have some command of English. And there's nothing I heard tonight about ID which says any proof of citizenship. You know, no U.S. passport, nothing except a driver's license, which you don't have to be a citizen to get a driver's license. I don't think some states you don't have to. And they do have to have some proof of local address. That's a good thing, too, because so those are my two concerns. One, that somebody comes in election day, wants to vote. This doesn't usually happen in Glencoe. And they have to have their utility bill or their tax bill or some proof that they live where they say they do. But nothing that says they're a citizen. Now, I'm looking around the room, and you know, typically, this is not an issue. It's not a black-white issue, because usually, almost always, those people are native-born. It's not an issue of somebody who's born in Puerto Rico. They're fine. But in every case in Niles, not to pick out a particular ethnic group, these were all Asians, elderly Asians with their children. Their children were fully fluent in English, and they were all citizens, and they were all on the rolls. But of course, for Election Day registration, they're not on the rolls. So that was my issue. Thank you.
Okay. First of all, thank you. We appreciate it. You know, we do try and be professional. You know, we can have our differences politically, but the bottom line is, when it comes to elections, you know, we really want to be fair and impartial. So I do thank you for that. And let me also, before I get to your points, let me introduce some people that are here with me, because you may have some issues after the meeting that you want to talk about. First of all, Barbara Gorell, raise your hand. Barbara is our chief of staff right now. Some of you know her mother, the former mayor of Skokie, right?
Right.
Barbara Gorell.
Pressel.
No, you're Barbara Pressel.
Right.
But you're...
It's Jackie Gorell.
Beautiful park named after her along the Barbara.
Thank you. Nice to see you, Barbara. Barbara was head of our tax department before. Okay. Next to her is Jan Klawick, who was head of our election department, so she knows a lot about that. Jan is now the deputy chief of staff, does a lot of different things. Next to Jan is Bill, as I mentioned, Bill Vassilopoulos. You spell your name, you get it free something. And Bill, like I say, is the guru of TIFs. People call him all over the country, all the state. The mayor's office will call regularly, even though they might not want to talk to me, but they'll want to talk to Bill. So we're lucky to have Bill. And if you have questions about your tax bill and so forth or whatever. Okay, in the back, Ryan, would you raise your hand? Ryan Chu, Evanston, right, Ryan?
Yeah.
Ryan is the deputy director of elections, okay? And he's a big mover in this all-in program. Also there, Muhammad, raise your hand. Muhammad Salami is in our election department, okay? Behind Ryan is Gail, okay, the wiper. Now, Gail is the one that you referred to, because Gail, well, she has a lot of hats right now. Among them is training election judges, but she's also a manager of several other things in our office and so forth. And I mentioned Mike Kreloff's name. Mike Kreloff is a work committeeman, but he's also an election law expert. That is, people seek him out for everything, and he does a job, a policy job for our office as a consultant, work on this election legislation. And all the legislative leaders in the governor's office, like I say, they turn to Mike wherever possible to get good, straight information. Okay, back to very important questions. First, I cannot deal with the language part, okay, because we don't have those requirements as to, you know, in the old days, I was a little older, I mean, almost every language, whether it was Italian or Greek or whatever, that they didn't speak the language but their kids did, how people get citizenized. So I can't deal with that issue about how articulate they are in the language or how they pass a test. But it's kind of talking together both about IDs and about citizenship. On citizenship, it's always been a very sensitive thing. Okay. All I can tell you is the requirement on everything is you have to be a citizen to vote. And everything you have says it right up front. The very first question they ask in most cases, are you a citizen? And then are you 18 of age? Which is the rule except for this new 17-year-old. So it's all very very prominent. Here's what I can tell you is that we know of no serious cases of people attempting to vote when they're non-citizens. We do know of a couple of cases. I mentioned NVRA and motor voter. The only cases we know about, and I don't want to exaggerate because there may be one or two someplace, that we know about are when people walk in, and I walk before, Larry works at the SOS, I walk in, I've got a green card with me, okay, I don't speak the language very well. They're supposed to ask me if I want to register to vote. And even if I got a green card, they register me. Now, it's really stupid if they do, okay? The worst thing is for that person. You might have read in the papers recently. Non-citizens do not want to be deported. They may want to vote. Okay? But if you register or vote improperly, you can be deported. It's something the League of Lone Voters, a lot of groups deal with it. So I don't think there's a problem, but as you may know, other states will send us your lists of, there is a problem between state law and federal government about getting, quote, citizen lists. But We do a lot of things. We share various information, like when people sign up to be, not sign up to be, when they're on the list for jury duty. People used to think, oh, well, I don't want to sign up for jury duty because I don't want to register to vote because of jury duty. Well, the fact is, it doesn't matter. You're going to get called either way. But we've a few cases where, we do all of our research. Someone says, here we got 10 names now. These people said they weren't citizens, and yet they voted. Okay. Every one of them, they were citizens. They just wanted to, they thought they were ducking the jury duty. So there are more ways we check on that by comparing. I don't know if that's a really good answer. Unfortunately, people do those kinds of things. On the ID, you asked if there's any changes. The only change, there's really no change in the precinct. Okay? There's still those exceptional cases where someone, and this is inside baseball, I'm sorry, but someone, he knows because he's a judge, may need ID because they didn't supply all the information necessary. Okay? But on election day, there's no changes.
They'll still need ID. Yeah. Where it says ID required, look at the ID.
Yeah, for that. Now, the only change in early voting is historically you've had to show a photo ID for early voting. You no longer need to do that. Okay. That was simply the legislature, when they implemented that early voting a few years ago, they required that because some states didn't, some counties didn't have enough technology. But the bottom line now is we have signature verification and all that. So the legislature decided to do away with that. So now we're consistent. You still have to have ID, and our focus on finding out who you are is in the registration process, not on election day. And that's probably one of the big controversies around the country.
David, let me just add, the General Assembly passed a driver's license for those who are undocumented, which is a very different kind of license. And it was done for a number of reasons. And I think what you're going to find is that those licenses stand out, and it is clear they are not American citizens who have those licenses. And I think that's going to...
Does it say on there? I'm not even...
It has a border that is different, and it indicates that this is it cannot be used for any identification purposes. It only allows a person to drive and to buy insurance under the insurance law. So I think what's going to happen is with that program is that's going to stop people who maybe went in and lied to get driver's licenses, and that's going to make it, I think, a little easier. This whole question, though, about what document do we have to prove we're American citizens? I mean, for most of us, the only document that we can get is a passport. I remember when I was in the service, we couldn't tell which of the people we served with were American citizens and which weren't, because nobody had a document, and there's a lot of discussion about it. But I think that the one thing that David said here is, if you suspect things, call their office. I mean, they may not confront that person there, but they'll look into it. I mean, the one thing that you said earlier, and I find on every election day, as I wander around my district, when there are issues, the troubleshooters that David's office sends out are extremely well-informed and immediately get right down to the issues that are at hand. And I mean, we want to run fair elections. I mean, the reason he has the reputation he has and gets asked to monitor is because we're doing a pretty good job in Cook County. This is not the clerk's office that existed in the 1980s with some characters who were clerk of the court and there were shenanigans. I mean, I think that the whole reason for going through these things tonight is to give you confidence. And, you know, I invited all of the committeemen, Democrats and Republicans, the League of Women Voters and other people to come here tonight because it's important for all of us to be on the same page in trying to make sure we know what the rules are and encouraging more people to register.
And we need lots of judges, Democrats and Republicans, so keep that in mind.
Yeah. And the kids, by the way, my experience is, and those of you who've been judges, these high school kids are the best thing that ever happens on the precincts because if you're the equipment manager, sometimes you know how to put the stuff together, but these kids put it together and explain it to the people during the day and everybody's happy. Other questions?
I had a question. First of all, thanks for all the advances. It's really great. As an election judge and as a deputy registrar, I embrace it. We were concerned as in our league about a rumor, and I just wondered if you could confirm it, there's a place for the email address, and it sounded like the email would be used to communicate if there was a problem, also to communicate you are now registered. But the third thing is what bothered us, and that was the email would be given to both the Democratic and Republican parties. Is that true?
You might need some help on that. Now, the email for when you do the
this
OBR online voter registration?
I don't know about online. I haven't seen that. But on the new form, it asks for your email, which is an optional piece.
You mean the
you
new
don't
state?
Have to give it.
The new state form?
The new deputy registrar to register a person.
Let me ask, because, you know, we try to be very careful that there are certain laws that where we have to give information to the parties, okay? And of course, we're very careful about that stuff. That's why we only use your last four digits, your Social Security. I don't know, anybody?
It's true,
Klein?
David. That's true.
Okay, it's true that the law says that if there is a email address, the political parties have the right to access to that. Okay, I think that's what you might call a political compromise. I'm speaking
just as phone number, when phone number was given, traditionally it's part of the public record, and so we have to provide it to those who ask for it, are entitled to those lists.
So it's a challenge, because, you know, we want that information, and for whatever reasons, I think the legislature said, well, that should be available to political parties, because remember, whether people like it or not, political parties have a fundamental role in the elections. The political parties pick the judges. Now, fortunately for us, most of them can't find judges, so we end up picking most of them. But and most of them do a pretty good job. There's some that don't. Okay, but yeah, that's so. In other words, part of the law in Illinois is a critical role for the political parties. And the theory, of course, behind that is that with both parties watching each other, you might be able to control things. So. Sorry, not the answer you wanted, but...
Yeah, the concern was mainly because we register in the high schools and giving out the students' ID or their email address was problematic for us, so we were sort of saying, don't do it. But I'm not sure that's the right answer either.
I think you want to just keep... Yeah, I think you got to do it and keep registering, and there's a lot of ways that political parties were, in other words, for example, the list the political parties have, both parties, are far more sophisticated than anything we have. Okay? They're kind of like corporations. There's data that, you know, every one of us, they have so much data on us, they could probably tell, you know, what I'm wearing under these. You know? So the fact is, it's out there. The key is we prefer to minimize its exposure.
Other questions?
A very basic question. For online voter registration, you have to have driver's license or state ID, and I assume that means you also, it has to be an up-to-date driver's license or state ID with a current, your current address on it?
Well, let's see, why would it have to be current? In other words, the key is that they know who you are, that so you're starting from there. So I would hope not, because lots of people don't update their driver's license. So you use that to get in, and then you're telling them that you've moved, and you want them to automatically re-register.
Okay.
So I think it wouldn't have to be.
Okay. Thank you.
I think it would have to be valid, but not current address.
Yeah, good point. Valid, but not
so
current.
Rare.
Right. Anything else?
Yes. What's the plan on state universities?
Yeah, Larry mentioned that, and I left it out because we're not affected yet. Sorry. Now, because of the new law, certain public universities, like Champaign, that are not actually in Cook County, will make voting available on election day, kind of just like same day. I got that right?
They'll make registration available.
No, voting. At a high traffic location on campus,
okay.
Where students who live in the precinct. Can vote, but also people from the adjacent precincts.
Okay. Again, it's trying to make it more convenient for students that might be, you know, many of them. Let's say you're in Champaign. You might be from Ohio, and you're going to vote in Ohio instead. But it's another vehicle, because we've had some issues with students. Okay, I mean, one of the big voter suppression things around the country is aimed at students. You know, you saw, like in Texas and North Carolina, you have a state ID from the State Department of Education in Texas. That's no good anymore. You have to re-register if you want to vote in Texas. Same thing in North Carolina. So Illinois is trying to go the opposite direction and say, hey, there's thousands of people down here. If they're legitimate citizens, they're the right age, they're citizens and so forth, let's make it a little more convenient. And so let's, and I'm not doing it everywhere, but like in Champaign is one example, let's make the campus a place where people can conveniently go. So that's...
And one of the reasons I mentioned it is many of these provisions actually have a sunset on them. And they'll be evaluated after we see what happens in this election. We should be encouraging children from this area who are at the University of Illinois and some of the, I don't remember all the other public institutions, but I think SIU and to use this, because if it works and if they see that this is a way that we've gotten people to vote, we'll get it expanded to cover places like Oakton Community College, like Northwestern, Loyola, and National Lewis and other places where we have campuses that are closer to us. And again, the idea is especially to get young people used to voting.
So that would be electronic voting where you would have the proper ballot for them wherever they reside, or is their residence now the university?
I can't speak for the place like Champaign. We're assuming it'll be electronic because you need to get all the different ballot styles.
Right. They would be voting within the jurisdiction where they're casting.
Yeah, they'd be voting in Champaign, but they'd be voting.
Right.
Yeah. But if they lived in Wilmette and school if they in lived. Champaign, then they're voting a Champaign ballot.
The students are the only people that have a choice. Okay, the rest of us don't. We vote, register and vote in one place. Students have a choice. You could be an Evanston student, and you could choose to vote in Evanston by mail, keep your resident here, or if you want, you could move your registration to where you're on campus, at least while you're a student at a university. So students is the one group that has that choice. So again, one of your kids could decide they wanted to move the registration to Champaign.
Right. Excuse me. It applies only in the case where students are actually registered wherever they're going to school.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, you can't go to Illinois State and then show up at Champaign and try and vote there.
Right. Right.
You can't vote at your Wilmette address in Champaign.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Because the Champaign County Clerk doesn't have that data.
Then you would still have to vote by mail or whatever for students who live here but go to school in Champaign or wherever. But for somebody who's in a graduate program and they just consider this university town, wherever it is, to be their residence, and they register to vote there, the idea was to establish a polling location on the campus that would be available basically to the students who go to school there, whether they live on campus or live in some other precinct off campus.
This idea about getting young people just used to voting is no small thing, because a lot of people in this room probably have rung doorbells or talked to people on the street. There's a lot of young people that say, I don't vote. Or they say, I don't believe any of those people anymore, so I'm not voting. So that's an uphill battle to even get young people. It's not everybody's out there as a big activist. A lot of them are not necessarily voters. And you want to make it as possible as much for them to get used to becoming a voter.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. But then, I had a conversation with my nephew who was at Brown University. I was shocked to find out that he didn't vote. I said, how come you don't vote? And he said, well, I don't know anything about it. I don't know who to vote for. And I thought, well, that's a valid reason. So...
That's a fair point. That's why we all try so hard. For example, we really push our website. When we send you notices about Election Day, we keep our website because that is real, particularly when you have such big elections and so many people on the ballot. And so what we try and remind you is we can show you, if you go to our website, we can show you all the races that are up. We even have an online where candidates want to give a little bio of themselves. So it is true that particularly you may know your state rep, your state senator, Larry, but it is difficult. And by having so many people on the ballot at once, particularly all these judges, And so we, the newspapers, other people do all they can to provide opportunities for people to learn more about them. And social media helps, technology is helping. Because nobody likes to go in and feel like they know nothing, because they don't want to find out I voted for somebody that goes to jail in 2 years.
But maybe in Rhode Island. Any other questions? If not, I want to thank David and his staff, and people will stay here and we'll answer questions. If you